So good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Prakrithi. I'm doing my DM in addiction medicine at CAM. I will be discussing today about the addictive properties of tobacco. And I've made this presentation with the guidance of Dr. Prabhat, sir. So coming to first thing, so what will we learn in this today's class? We will learn about the chemical constituents of tobacco, the neurobiological effects of nicotine, and how nicotine dependence or addiction develops. So tobacco is prepared from the processed leaves of the plant Nicotiana tobacum. So nicotine is the primary psychoactive component, and it can cause tachycardia and increased BP. So the smoke also contains carbon monoxide, which would bind to your hemoglobin with a very high affinity to form carboxyhemoglobin. And this causes hypoxia and acidosis in the body. Now, another component is the tar. The tar contains the particulate matter, which is suspended in the smoke, and it consists of a lot of substances. Some molecules like acrolein and hydrogen cyanide cause damage to the respiratory mucosa, which prevents, so it damages the cilia, and it prevents movement of the debris and microbes out of the respiratory tract. And some of the polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons and tobacco specific nitrosamines or TSNAs are carcinogenic, and they can have a risk of lung cancer. So the tobacco products have a lot of alkaloids which are psychoactive. Some of these are nicotine. There are also others called norcotinine and anatabine and anabasin as well. The major one is nicotine. So most of it gets metabolized to cotinine, which further undergoes changes such as glucuronidation and N-oxidation and so on. And all of these products then get excreted out of the body. Nicotine is consumed in oral, nasal, and smoked forms, like you all are aware of. And the distribution is such that the highest affinity is in the liver, kidneys, spleen, and lungs, and the lowest in adipose tissue. Even the brain has a high affinity, and receptor binding capacity is increased in the smokers compared to non-smokers. And like you can see on the right side of the slide, the different routes of consumption would lead to different patterns of the blood nicotine concentration. You can see that the smoking produces a steep peak in the first few minutes and then a stable decline over the next few minutes. And oral snuff and chewing tobacco have a lesser of the acute increase and more of a plateau kind of picture. So when a person inhales a smoke from a cigarette, the nicotine is carried into the lungs. From there, it is absorbed into the pulmonary venous circulation. From venous circulation, it goes to the arterial circulation. And then from there, it goes to the brain. Nicotine then diffuses into the brain tissue. There are certain receptors called nicotinic acetylcholine receptors, or NACHRs. So, and nicotine is a cholinergic agonist. When it binds to the channel will open, and sodium and calcium would enter inside the cell. So the nicotine would increase activity in a lot of areas of the brain, such as prefrontal cortex, thalamus, and basal ganglia as well. And stimulation would also lead to a release of different neurotransmitters in the brain. And these can be norepinephrine, acetylcholine, serotonin, and so on. So one of the major things is it causes the release of dopamine in something called the ventral tegmental area, which releases dopamine into nucleus accumbens. This is a very critical part of the reward pathway, which I will be explaining further. So along with reward, there are other things also which nicotine has an effect on. So by increasing the acetylcholine and norepinephrine, it would increase arousal or wakefulness. With dopamine, norepinephrine, and serotonin, it can cause appetite suppression. And with acetylcholine and glutamate, it can help in cognitive enhancement. And with GABA and beta endorphin, it helps to decrease in anxiety. And let's see how this process happens. So every drug would act in a different way. So each cell would have some receptors, transporters, and some channels which help the neurotransmitters and other molecules to enter and exit the cell. A drug can go and block a transporter, which increases dopamine in the synaptic space. Some of the drugs go and modify the channel activity. And this can cause either depolarization or hyperpolarization of the cells. Some drugs which will are there, they will mimic the neurotransmitters which are already there in the body and then cause change. And nicotine is one such drug. It occupies this nicotinic cholinergic receptor and then produces the action. All these actions then finally lead to certain chemical changes, which sends messages down the line, and this cell to regulate some of the processes, and it can lead to some permanent changes in the functioning of the cell. So putting it all together, the brain learns to adapt to the presence of a high level of nicotine in the circulation. So this is the dopamine reward pathway, which I was talking about. So it's a network of tissue in the midbrain. So it elicits feelings of pleasure in response to certain stimuli. The important structures are the VTA or the ventral tegmental area, the nucleus accumbens, and the prefrontal cortex. Usually, even the other behaviors naturally stimulate the reward pathway. These are eating to reduce hunger, drinking water to alleviate thirst, or sexual activity. And as a primitive neurochemical level, the stimulation of the reward pathway leads to reinforcement of the behavior. And so these behaviors would be repeated again and again. So these are behaviors which are actually necessary for continued survival of the organism. But then with drug, what happens is this pathway gets hijacked, and then say, for example, nicotine would stimulate the release of dopamine in the midbrain. And then because of this, there's a feeling of euphoria and pleasure. And then the reward pathway gets activated. And in order to get the same high again and again, the use becomes regular. And this leads me to the next addiction cycle. So this addiction cycle happens in three stages. The binge intoxication, which is the stage at which one would consume the intoxicating substance and experience the effects. So in this stage, there will be a lot of dopamine in the reward pathway. And then with continued use, it can lead to habit formation. And which means that now the behavior is going to occur irrespective of whether the reward occurred or not. And the next stage is the withdrawal or the negative effect. And this stage, the individual would experience a negative emotional state when the substance is not there. So that correlates with a low dopamine in the reward pathway. And then there is decreased motivation to do other things which are unrelated to the drug. And then when next stage is preoccupation and anticipation, where the individual would keep on seeking for the substance again and again and doing activities in order to procure the substance. So the nicotine causes the increase in neurotransmitters, then brain would down-regulate these receptors as a compensatory mechanism. Now, what happens is that the ability to derive pleasure from the naturally rewarding activities gets lost, and this would make the person not to engage in other activities. And then the person would require the nicotine to even experience normal levels of well-being. So that's why it becomes so difficult to stop once it starts and becomes a habit. So let's look at this. So this is a figure that is showing a typical nicotine addiction cycle of a cigarette smoker of one day. The one day smoking cycle is represented here. This jagged line, the line which is going up and down, that represents the venous plasma concentration of nicotine as a cigarette is smoked every 40 minutes or 1 hour from 8 a.m. to 9 p.m. Then the upper solid line, that indicates the threshold concentration where it above that there is pleasure and arousal. And this lower line indicates a line where below that when the concentration goes, then the withdrawal symptoms start occurring. The gray color shaded area, that is the zone where it is called a neutral zone, in which the smoker would be comfortable without experiencing any pleasure or arousal or withdrawal symptoms. And so what happens is, after smoking the first cigarette of the day, the smoker would experience a significant amount of arousal and wakefulness, and no other cigarette produces this much of the effect. And for this reason, it is most of them say that my first cigarette is the most important of the day. And after this tolerance starts to develop, the threshold would for both pleasure and arousal and withdrawal keep rising progressively. And then the smoker keeps becoming tolerant to the effect of nicotine. And then overnight, when the smoking is stopped, the loss of tolerance happens and the same cycle continues the next day. So this is how the addiction to nicotine or tobacco starts developing. So to summarize, nicotine is the primary psychoactive compound found in tobacco. It acts on the nicotinic cholinergic receptors. It mediates the neurotransmitter release, like we discussed, and it has an important role in arousal, cognitive enhancement, appetite suppression, and mood modulation. And smoking produces a very quick tolerance and greater withdrawal symptoms. And because of this, the addictive property is very high. So that's, I come to the end of my presentation.